Hallelujah and good evening. This is your friend and Pastor George Mulinge coming to you from Mount Zion Worship Center with your favorite program, Kingdom Moments. And today we want to focus on something that we started working on last Thursday. And I'm excited that during this season, towards this end of the year 2021, that God laid in my heart to discuss something on Christmas, and therefore our focus is on the full scope of this whole matter that we discuss or we celebrate or we converse around within this season in time that has to do with the birth of Jesus Christ. And therefore the title of our message has been The Christmas Messenger and His Message. Today being the second part, or moving on to the second part, I want to remind us a couple of things that we began to see when we started looking at this. The first thing is that we started seeing that this whole matter of the birth of Jesus Christ is a matter in God's economy that happened at the fullness of time. Because of what Paul tells us in Galatians 4:4, that in the fullness of time, God sent forth His Son, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those who were under the law, that we might receive the adoption as sons. And we were able to discuss about seven things that God has already revealed to those in the Old Testament, even before Jesus Christ was born. God used His prophets right from Moses, and they began to speak forth concerning the birth or the coming of the one, the very one that we know as Christ Jesus, even before He was born. And therefore, the sixth thing, let me remind you very quickly, we discovered, one, that the birth of Jesus is closely linked to the purpose of man's creation. He was actually born to link up with the purpose to why man was created. And then two, we also discovered that the birth of Jesus reveals God's promise that He had promised to David. David being one of the forefathers of Israel, God had given him a promise that when his days are fulfilled and he rests with his fathers, He will set up a seed after him, and this seed would come after his own body, and he will establish his kingdom. That is what we had begun to see. And number three, having been the birth of Jesus, reveals the manner on how the birth would occur. So God revealed this on how it will be done long before it even happened. And fourthly, God revealed the place where that birth would take course. So it's not something that, you know, happened randomly or in obituary. It's something that was in God's mind even before time began. The purpose of His birth, when He will be born, the place He will be born, and even fifthly, the period and time, the exact period and the exact time when He would be born. The last one we discovered, God had revealed what kind of a person, His character and purpose He would actually portray. And today I would like us to move on to the next part of this. And we look at part two, and I would give it a title, Faith Concerning the Birth of God's Son. So as we'll begin to move on to transcend, having known this thing that had been revealed concerning Him to the Old Testament prophets, right from Moses, all the way through the prophets and the Psalms, up to the time that it was revealed, I would like us to focus on something, on how those who heard or those who saw what God had spoken and believed in it, what examples or what can we be able to learn from them. And then we'll move on progressively to the time, even to the actual happening of the event, maybe in the next part that we will be dealing with. As we begin to look at this, I would like us to look at some key factors in understanding this whole thing about the birth of Jesus Christ. Because God revealed it in the Old Testament that it would happen, connected to the purpose for man's creation. He will be the Redeemer. He will connect people back to God. And having done and put all this together, including the time to which he would be born and the place that his birth would occur, those who had heard about it only need to put faith in what God has spoken concerning his coming. And that remains even a reason for today for us to put faith in the purpose and the reason of his coming. Now, as we begin to juggle around this, number one, we may need to ask ourselves, what is faith? If we are to put faith concerning that what God had revealed concerning his son before he was born. Faith, what is this faith and why is it key in expanding this whole revelation of God's plan concerning his son to us? Faith, coming from the Greek word pistis, simply means believing what God has said concerning a matter. Hallelujah. It simply means believing what God has said concerning a matter. Those who believed the prophecies or that which had been said concerning the forthcoming or the birth of Jesus Christ had to do so by putting faith in what they had read from the scriptures, what they had learned from the books or from the word of God. As a matter of fact, the Bible tells us that faith cometh by hearing and hearing by the word of God. Without the word of God, we cannot know the mind of God. It's through the word of God when we get to know what is in his plan and what has been predetermined of him. And we will notice something that throughout the whole of human history, there has been the choice to believe that which God has said, act upon it or not. Throughout history, man has been presented with a choice right from the time of Adam and Eve in the garden. Has been presented whether to believe on that which God has said or not to believe on that which God has said. The subject matter is about the birth of the Lord Jesus Christ, who was a messenger of God and his message with a good message to the whole world. And now, and as the scripture remains clear about the announcement of this birth of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Messiah, right from Adam and the woman in the garden, all through to Abraham, to Israel, Kadesh Barnea, and to those alive at Christ's birth, to this present day, is something that faith must continue to be put in order to actualize the purpose why he came. His purpose of coming doesn't end after his birth. It continues to be worked out until he comes back. And therefore, I'd like us to sample out a few protagonists, a few people, a few faith heroes, so to speak, recorded in the Bible, that had something concerning his coming or concerning his birth, that which God had revealed concerning the birth of the Lord Jesus Christ. And they put faith, they mixed it with faith and believed in God concerning that very thing about his coming. The first person that we're looking at is Mary. Mary stands out as a key figure in all these things. In fact, without the faith of Mary concerning the appearing or the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ or the revealing of the Lord Jesus Christ, if she never lined up our faith or herself in tandem with what God had spoken and believed in it, there would be no Messiah. So we thank God that Mary patterned our life, our belief system, our faith in accordance with the word of God. Remember, we realize that this faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God. And faith is basically believing God concerning a matter. And the matter in view, as we have said before, has to do with the birth of Christ and what God had begun to reveal, what God had begun to say over the ages concerning that which will happen following the birth or in passage to the birth of the Lord Jesus Christ. Let's look at Mary for a little while. And I'll go to the book of Luke, chapter number 1, verses number 26, verse number 38. These are scriptures that we read every time during Christmas. But let's put in some study into them and see what God has to reveal to us. The Bible says, now in the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent by God to a city of Galilee named Nazareth, verse number 27, to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David. The virgin's name was Mary. And having come in, the angel said to her, "Rejoice, highly favored one, for the Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women." But when she saw him, she was troubled at his saying and considered what manner of greeting this was. Then the angel of the Lord said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And behold, you will conceive in your womb and bring forth a son, and shall call his name Jesus. He will be great, and he will be called the Son of the Highest. And the Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there shall be no end." Then Mary said to the angel, listen to that, "How can this be, since I do not know a man?" Verse number 35. And the angel of the Lord answered and said to her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Highest will overshadow you. Therefore also, that Holy One who is to be born will be called the Son of God. Now indeed, Elizabeth, your relative, has also conceived a son in her old age. And this is now the sixth month for her who was called barren. For with God, nothing with him shall be impossible." Then Mary said, "Behold the maidservant of the Lord. Let it be to me according to your word." And the angel departed. Very interesting. So we're seeing that Mary here playing a very key and a very important role in believing that which God had said concerning the birth of Jesus Christ. And I would like you to see something that the angel draws attention to as he tells her of this incredible event that is documented in 2 Samuel chapter number 7, where we read when God used prophet Nathanael to prophesy that when the days of David are long gone, God would raise up a seed from his own body that would reign over his kingdom. And therefore, Mary is to believe in the word of God. If she doesn't believe in that which has been revealed from the word of God, then she would put the entire plan of God into a great tension. I imagine at that point, if Mary never accepted, what would have happened? Of course, God would have done something else, but it would not have failed to happen, because the Bible tells us that the works were finished from before the foundation of the world. There was no way that Mary was going to thwart or to circumvent God's plan as it had already been predetermined. But I would like you to see something. Mary already knew. How did she know? She knew by the word of God. And that's why she said, "Although I do not know a man, let it be according to your word." She had learned that faith cometh from hearing, and hearing by the word of God. In other words, Mary had built up herself in the word of God. She had taken good time taking in and engaging correctly with the word of God. So when the angel of the Lord appeared, because of the word deposits that were in her, the word in her grew faith, and she was able to connect with what God was saying. That tells us when we engage correctly with the word of God, it is possible that when the word of the Lord comes at the appointed time, that we can be able to connect with it concerning a matter. Praise the name of the Lord. So the word of the Lord that had come at this point concerning a matter was that you are the vehicle. You are the highly favored one to be able to bring forth the Messiah. Will you agree, Mary? And Mary said, "Oh, let it be according to your word." She didn't understand many things about it, but she said, "Let it be according to your word." Hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord. Therefore, God promises that he will send a sign. The sign of a barren womb of another lady. And through that sign, God would show her how miracles happen. And when you go through back the pages and the chronicles of history, You will see miracles how God performed through Sarah and Isaac and brought forth a son of promise. And when Mary, I suggest, when she went back and read these stories of God's faithfulness on how a barren woman, a person written off, would bring forth a son, she had every reason to believe that God would even bring life to our dead or to our womb that has no seed. Hallelujah. So Mary's response is what is very key in our discussion today, that she responded based on the word that was in her heart. She said, "Let it be unto me according to your word." And I want to ask you, my friend, are you saying with Mary, "Lord, let it be unto me according to your word"? In whatever you may be going through today, your challenges and your whatever you are you willing, are you strong enough to receive the will of God concerning your life? Maybe Mary was not planning anything of that nature. She had her own thoughts. And a lot of times we have our own thoughts, we have our own problems, we have our own issues. But I want you to realize something, that God's plan for your life is greater than your own problems. God's will for your life is greater than your current problems. Maybe Mary was thinking about other things. Maybe she was planning how matters will be about her life, but God had a different plan for her life. I want to make strong suggestions that regardless of the problems and the things that you may be going through today, God doesn't want you to focus on yourself. He wants you to focus on His will. Let your will be done. God wants His will to be done. And when the will of God is done in your life, all these other things will be put in place. And this is Mary, a woman of faith, mixing faith with the things that she has heard, putting faith into action. Let it be according to your word. Hallelujah. Let it be unto me according to your word. Amen. Imagine if she never believed in God, what would have happened? There would be, again, such a shock in the entire universe. But God did not design it to be so. And that's why she is actually called, because of her faith, the highly favored one. When you have faith in God, when you have believed, when you have been able to come to faith to that which God has revealed in His word, you are considered as a highly favored one, just as Mary was. Another person that we can be able to relate with, a person that dared believe God concerning that which God had said concerning His son, is a man known as Simeon. Let's look at the book of Luke, chapter number 2, verse number 25, 35. The first one we see Mary, and the second one here is Simeon. The Bible says, "And behold, there was a man," verse number 25, "a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon. And this man was just and devout and waiting for the consolation of Israel. And the Holy Spirit was upon him, and it had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not see death before he had seen the Lord's Christ. So he came by the Spirit into the temple. And when the parents brought in the child, Jesus, to do for him according to the custom of the law, he took him up in his hands and blessed God and said, 'Lord, now you are letting your servant depart in peace according to your word. For my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared before the face of all people, a light to bring revelation to the Gentiles and the glory of your people Israel.' And Joseph and his mother marveled at those things which were spoken of him. Then Simeon blessed them and said to Mary, his mother, 'Behold, this child is destined for awe and rising of many in Israel, and for a sign which will be spoken against. Yes, a word will pierce through your own soul also, that the thoughts of many hearts may be revealed.'" Hallelujah. Remember, to the casual observer, this is just a young couple, probably among as many also who have come for the circumcision of the newborn baby that day. Yet Simeon's faith is unwavering. You find the man was waiting for the consolation of the nation of Israel. He had read through the books. He had understood by the word of the Lord, the revealed word of God concerning God's plan for the birth of his son. And therefore, he was waiting and he was not ready to die until God had brought in the consolation of Israel through the birth of the Messiah. And therefore, he was waiting fervently in faith. I love this. He was waiting in faith, declaring in his heart, I'm not ready to die before I see the salvation of the people of Israel. He had gone through the books and understood what God has spoken, what God had revealed concerning the birth of his son. And I think this is very important when we begin to think about Christmas and we celebrate, not just celebrate casually. Let's go back to the scriptures and understand the reason why God set up the birth of Jesus Christ and what really it means to us and what he has revealed through his word. Just like these people, when they heard about it, they connected themselves and they organized their lives in accordance to that which God has said, and they were ready to be in line with what God would reveal concerning the birth of his son. We are celebrating everywhere in the world today, and in the days to come, the celebrations will heighten. The question is, what are you celebrating? Do you know the reason? Are you aware of the purposes of God, of that which God has revealed concerning the birth of Jesus Christ at this time in point? The third person we see that had organized our life in faith to that which God has revealed concerning the birth of his son is Anna. The Bible tells us in the book of Luke chapter number 2, verse 36 to 38, talking about Anna. Now there was one Anna, a prophetess, the daughter of Phanuel of the tribe of Asher. She was of great age and had lived with her husband 7 years from her virginity. And this woman was a widow of about 84 years, who did not depart from the temple, but served God with fastings and prayers night and day. And in that instant, she gave thanks to the Lord and spoke of him to all those who looked for redemption of Israel. Look at this woman, a widow who had lived for 84 years and having been married only for 7 years. You know, she is referred as to the prophetess of God. The Bible tells us about her single-mindedness to her devotion to the things of God. She was so devoted to seeing, just like Simeon, looked forward to the redemption of the people of Israel. And therefore, she decided to give herself. She chose, after the death of her husband, Anna chose not to marry again, but put herself rather to serve God with fastings and prayer. After the husband's dying, she decided that I'll not be married again. I will serve the Lord with fastings and prayer as she looked forward and waiting for the birth of Jesus Christ, for the redemption of the people of Israel. Look at how these people looked forward to the birth of Jesus Christ, because God had promised Israel redemption. God had promised the nation a reconciliation, a forgiveness of the nation through the birth of a son. And therefore, these individuals organized themselves to believe in that which God had already said in his word. And they were waiting in faith. Faith that cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. And it appears that she is not just alone. It's not just Anna, because we have seen this contingent of people waiting for the consolation of Israel. And I want to make it clear to us that we are people that have given themselves to loving God and to seeking the Lord. Join those people that are looking forward, this time not only to his birth, but those who are looking for Christ to be born in their hearts every day on a continuous basis as they look forward to his coming back. Praise the name of the Lord. This is quite something. The last one, the number 4, is the wise man. We have Mary, we have Simeon, we have Anna, and now we have the wise men. All these people were looking forward And they had believed God on what he had said concerning the birth of his son. They had believed the scriptures, they had believed the prophets, and they were looking forward without wavering concerning the birth of the Son of God. And therefore, in Matthew 2, verse 1 to 2, we see the story of the wise men. The Bible says, "Now after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judah, in the days of Herod the king, behold, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem, saying, 'Where is he who has been born king of Jews? For we have seen his star and in the east and have come to worship him.'" Hallelujah. See, the Bible calls them wise men, the Magi. Those guys, it had been revealed to them through the prophets and through the word of God that the Christ, the Messiah, would be born. And they set up in a journey. We're not talking about or focusing so much on their on their vocation or on their work, but they, in their heart, deep, though being astronomers or people who study the stars and so forth, theirs was not so much on seeking or, you know, doing anything about the stars. They were looking wisely to where Jesus Christ had been born. And therefore, coming to King Herod and asking him where this king was born is a profound thing. Consider the Bible calling him wise men. And Moses had spoken about wise men long time in his books. In the book of Numbers, chapter number 27, verse number 17, the Bible says, "I see him, but now I behold him, but not near. A star shall come out of Jacob, a scepter shall rise out of Israel, and batter the brow of Moab, and destroy all the sons of Tamar." Moses had seen, like in a mirror, in a distance, he had seen this wise man coming, seeking for Jesus. Oh my God. Because they had believed in what they had studied from the scriptures. And therefore, it's such an amazing thing. There is absolutely no doubt in their minds as to whom they had come to see. They had come to see the one who has been born, the King of Jews. Hallelujah. And therefore, where would they look for this person that would be born as the King of Jews? They would only look in accordance with what they had heard, or what they had read, what they had studied, what it had been revealed in the scripture, that in the house of David, that the one that would sit on the throne would be born. So they did not miss the mark. They did not go to different directions. They went directly to the places that the scriptures had revealed. And this tells me something. For those of us who dwell in the scriptures and walk in the spirit, let me tell you, we are guided, we are led of the Lord in the way we should go. I love what the Bible says in Psalms 32, verse number 8. It says, "I'll lead you, I'll guide you with my eye upon you, I'll show you the way you should go." When we rightly engage with the Word of God and walk in the Spirit, God will order, he will direct us our ways. We'll not go anywhere every other person is going. We will follow the ways of the Lord. Praise the name of Jesus. And therefore they asked, "We want to know, we want to go and see where this king has been born, because we have seen his star. We have heard his report." Praise the name of the Lord. And the Bible says, you know, he came to his own, according to John 1:11. He came to his own. In other words, he came, or this refers to coming to his own things. He came to his own people, to his own things, and his own, that referring to his people, did not receive him. Did not receive him from, but those who received him, he gave them power to become the children of God. This is profound, believing what God said concerning the birth of Jesus Christ. God had said that through this Jesus Christ, that God will establish a throne in the house of David, and that the rulership of all the earth, the rulership of his own people, the rulership of Israel, although they rejected him, was now being offered to them. Hallelujah. But now they would not receive. This is profound. They would not accept it. It was brought to them, but they would not receive. We thank God for his word because he's so faithful. My question is tonight, We have seen that there are four accounts in the Bible that show us of these people that align themselves. They mix their what they heard with the word of God concerning the birth of Jesus Christ. The Bible says he came to bring salvation. He came that you and me and I can be saved. The question is, have you ever believed in that which God has said concerning the coming of the Son of God? Today, we are celebrating his birth because he has brought salvation. Have you ever been saved? Would you consider today to mix that which you have heard concerning the Son of God with faith? Would you allow faith to be born in your heart today that you may get saved? The Bible says you shall call his name Jesus. Hallelujah. And that name Jesus means the Savior, the one who saves. Will you receive the Savior today? He is the reason for the season. He was born that you may be saved, that your life may be changed. Let's pray together. Pray with me. Say, Lord Jesus, today I come before you. I believe in that which is revealed in Scripture concerning your birth. And today, during this Christmas season, I open up my heart. I welcome you in my life to be the King and the Lord of my life. Come in and dwell in my heart. Come in, lead me, and change my life this Christmas. Make my life a different life. I am decided to follow you, and I'm not turning back. Hold my hand and walk with me, Lord Jesus. I love you from this day forward. Amen. Father, thank you for this beloved friend that has just welcomed Jesus into their life. I thank you, Father, that you are holding their hands and you're walking with them. Lord, we give you glory and we give you praise. Give them strength to continue in this journey of faith. And may you change their lives in Jesus' name. You've just been saved. Receive the Lord of glory. May God help you to walk with him, to live in him. And I want to invite you to go to my YouTube channel, George Mulinge Ministries. Just go to YouTube, subscribe, like, and comment. There you will find lots of videos that will help you. Just take some time and listen. This will change your life. Thank you so much for tuning in. I am so, so excited. May God bless you, and may you enjoy Christmas. And may Christ be born in your life, not today, but every day. God bless you.